This video is a direct continuation of the last part of the series that took place in Houdini, where we masked a basic terrain according to a variety of features and then converted those features to an ID map using some volume wrangles. In the last video, we carried out all of these operations as a linear chain of operations for simplicity's sake, and we didn't worry about making our logic reusable or modular in any way. In this video, we're going to create a digital asset that wraps up some of this functionality into a reusable node for use in larger and more complex projects. Okay, first off, we're going to copy that geometry network there, and we'll go ahead and name this IDMap Digital Asset. Okay, we'll hop inside the new network, and I'll just call out here that if you may have noticed this yourself, we're running inside of Houdini 20. I just opened the old Houdini 19 project inside of Houdini 20 and everything just works. And we're not going to be focusing on any of the differences between Houdini 19 and 20 in this video. Okay, so the part of the network that we care about mostly that's doing the heavy lifting is the series of volume wrangles here, which is encoding the mask into the different IDs of the IDMap texture. And you can see that if we click on each of these in turn, that essentially the logic inside each of these wrangles is the same. So what we're going to do is we're just going to copy this out to the side, shallow slopes. Let's just rename this ID from mask. And straight away, we're going to go ahead and collapse it to a subnet. So this is the start of our modular reusable weight or height field mask to ID node. In fact, let's just go ahead and create that now. We go ahead and create a digital asset. You can see that this interface has changed a bit from Houdini 19, but still fundamentally the same. I'm going to call this weight to ID. I don't care about adding the author namespace or the version. And I'm just going to add it to the Pegasus submenu. And then pick a location on disk. For the sake of this demo, I'm just saving it to the location of the project. I'm going to overwrite the height field ID from layers node that I created as a test. Okay. I'm going to go ahead and hit create. And now we need to choose what parameters that we want to expose on the top level, on the top level of this digital asset. So there are a couple of obvious ones. We want to choose the threshold, of course, and we're going to want to choose the sort of ID map value that we want to encode. We're also going to want to choose the name of the mask that is getting applied, that is getting sort of thresholded, or the mask that's getting converted to the ID map. So in order to do that, I'm actually just going to set it to a new layer that doesn't yet exist called ID mask. There we go. And then I'm going to put down a height field copy layer ahead of the ID from mask. We're going to copy that name that we created as the destination. So now we can grab the source from the height field copy layer and copy and drag that over into the digital asset parameters. So what that's going to do now is create a new ID mask layer from the mask that we supply into the source. And that's what's going to be passed through the volume wrangle. Okay. So now if I change, we can see actually we have a list now. And I click on this drop down of all of the layers we can choose from. So we have AO, we have slopes, we have sediment, and we have the ability to change the threshold of each of those. Okay, so that's part one. We can now copy this digital asset. You can change the ID map value, choose a different layer, change the threshold, and you can see that we've now got the same behavior that we had previously inside of our volume wrangles, encapsulated inside of a digital asset with a nice clean UI. So the next part of the process of creating a reusable and sort of flexible digital asset is that I would like to make this work outside of make it so that it no longer requires the sort of linear chain of operations that we have here. And the reason for that is because with this sort of long stream of linear operations, if we were to make a modification to the slopes mask, every node below that is going to have to recook. And while this is quite a simple network and that recook will happen very quickly, on an actual production project, it's likely that the masks are going to be a lot more complex with a lot more operations happening with many more masks. So we definitely want each of these individual masks to be decoupled from all of the others. So this is quite simple. It's quite a simple thing that we can do here. We can just go ahead and sort of separate them out like so into three separate streams. Okay, so now if we make a modification to the slopes mask, it won't require a recook of the AO mask or the flow field and vice versa. The problem now is that we're only passing down the result of the sediment, and we need some way of getting the contents of these masks to the relevant weight to ID node. How are we going to achieve that? Well, to begin with, I'm just going to deconnect all of these, and this portion of the network is now only existing as a reference. I'll be continuing to work on this new graph over here using the digital assets we've just created. First of all, we need to supply an input. The input that I'm going to supply is an object merge, which is going to be using this, or targeting this null height field, which is the height field prior to any masking. And again, the reason we choose that is so that if we make a modification to any of the masks, it doesn't immediately require a recook of all the weight to ID nodes. So how do we get each of these masks supplied to the relevant weight to ID mode? Well, we're going to do the same thing to create an object merge for each of these. Got the slopes, got the AO, we've got the sediment. Okay, so we have our three masks with the added benefit that we can actually see the mask visualized with the native height field mask visualization on each of the object merges. So we have a bit of additional clarity over what mask is being supplied to which ID. We just need to find a way to connect these masks up to the relevant weight to ID nodes. Okay, so first of all, we need to remember to go and hook up our IDMap visualizer so that we can actually see the information sort of represented visually on the screen as we start to feed data from the masks into the IDs. And then what we can do is we can just use a height field layer node like so to copy over slopes from the right stream onto the left stream. We can now see that that is being carried over from the right. If we were to skip the layer node, nothing would happen. We wouldn't see anything. So that's now being copied over from the right stream to the left. But we don't want to have to use this height field layer node separately every time that we put down a weight to ID. So what we're going to do is we're going to enable editing again on our digital asset. We're just going to go ahead and cut that layer out, paste it inside, and then we need to go to the type properties of this digital asset and add another input. So there's now two possible inputs. I'm going to call the first input height field. I'm going to call the second input mask. We can wire the slopes into the second mask and then wire that subnetwork input into the layer. The last thing that we need to do is we just need to make sure that we're copying the name, the expression. We're going to paste the expression there. So it's going to be using the same CHS source name from the top level of the digital asset as the copy to layer, which means it's getting the same named layer as the copy layer is going to use, which means it's now going to be using that second input instead of the first input as the source for the masks. But as you can see, if we then go down to the second weight to ID, we get an error saying that there's not enough sources specified. So while we would expect the digital asset to mainly be used in this way, requiring two inputs, we're just going to add a little switch condition that allows it to cook successfully, even if that second input isn't provided. So essentially, it will default to looking for masks that are contained in the left-hand string, which would give us the same behavior that we had in the first place as a sort of fallback option. So where we can do that, so we can do switch if. We're going to wire first subnetwork input into the left pin there. We're going to wire the output of the layer into the second input. And then we're going to check against the spare input 0. So that will give us this additional parameter, which we can fill with a reference to a node. We're going to create a null node, wire that in between the layer and the second subnetwork input. I'm going to call that in mask. And we can just drag that on there. We'll say element count if the number of primitives is greater than 0, then we're going to use the write stream, as in we will be copying the mask from that input. And if it doesn't exist, if there's no primitives, then we'll just use the left stream there. What we can see now is that if we save the changes, first node here, as expected, uses the right-hand chain to supply the mask. But this left input doesn't. This left second wait to ID doesn't provide any cooking errors. It still works, and it's expecting this source slopes to exist on that left stream there. Just to verify, we can do a height field mask by feature and copy that down there. And we need to remember that even though this is masking the slopes, the layer that's being written to is actually called mask. So we also need to copy the layer there. And because we use that $OS sign here, the layer that's being created is actually called slopes one. So we can just call this slopes two. You can see now it's called slopes two. So if I have a look on here, we can see it finds that slopes two. And if I just change this, it's now getting the information from that left-hand chain as before. So that was just to illustrate that you can do this either way. We don't want to work that way. We, of course, want to get the input from the write stream. We want to get the... Oh, interestingly, it's not finding the name of the AO. Wonder why that might be. Well, we're going to type in AO. So it is working, even though it didn't supply that name to this dropdown. And there we can quickly and easily set up the remaining. IDs. And hopefully should be obvious that with this way of structuring the graph, it's not only a lot clearer which mask is driving which ID, but also that we're able to benefit from faster cooking, because when we modify the contents of one of these masks, it's not going to require a recook of all of the inputs. And this left-hand stream of the where the actual conversion from the weight to the ID happens will cook really quickly anyway, because it's basically just a single volume wrangle. Okay, now there's something additional we can do to sort of take the burden off of the user and allow us to forget entirely about the naming of all of these layers. So we can actually just go ahead and set the source to default to mask, and nothing changes. Well, why is that? It's simply because as these streams are now separated, we can do away with the necessity to name all of these layers different names. And effectively, where we set up these copy layers before to do that renaming, we could essentially replace all of these with nulls. So let's just go ahead and do that. We just need to wire in, wire those nulls in place of the copy layers. So go ahead and delete. We can just call this slopes, AO, and flow. And we have that organizational clarity, but we're no longer required to manage the names of all of the layers either. So another little benefit there. And yeah, that's pretty much all there is to it. One thing to bear in mind is that in order for the ID maps to be visualized correctly, the way that you would want them to, you of course do have to do this ID map creation step, and you do have to use this height field visualize step. So what I'm just going to go ahead and do is I'm just going to go and copy this logic inside of the digital asset so that it's always there in some form or another. So first of all, let's copy the ID map. So we're going to copy from the mask into a layer called IDMap, and we're going to leave copy source data and replace existing off. So that basically just means if the IDMap already exists, then we're not going to overwrite it. But if the IDMap does not exist, then we'll create one, but it will be empty. Okay. So that means we can save that asset and delete this copy layer. And you can see the display is still working. So that's one less thing we need to remember to do when we're doing this workflow. And then I suppose the last thing that you might want to do is to find a way to embed the visualize into the Weight2ID itself. And this is actually unexpectedly complex, or it can be, depending on how you want to go about doing it. For the sake of simplicity in this case, I'm just going to create, you're going to use the default coloration scheme. I'm going to pick one, infrared. There you go. That gives us quite a clear distinction between the different layers. But bear in mind that as you increase the layer count, because we only have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different color swatches, we're not going to end up with a unique color per layer. We're going to end up with each ID somewhere on this sort of band or rainbow. So this is kind of the simplest way of doing it. For our project, on Project Pegasus, we did actually use some Python to sort of dynamically populate one of these ramps. And I may do a sort of spin-off video exploring slightly more sort of technical topic of how do we use Python to modify parameters on other nodes, but that goes beyond the scope of this specific tutorial. So what we're simply going to do is we're just going to cut that visualize, and we will paste it in probably at the end there. And we just need to make sure that the range here covers the full range of IDMap values. So what we can do is just check what layers exist. So we can see that we've got height, mask, and IDMap. So on the right here, actually, let's just try this first of all. I'm going to try volume max. Get the 0th index, the first index, that's just the first input pin. And then the primitive ID would be 2, because it was the third. And we can see what is that? 0.07. Doesn't seem quite right. We just double check the index. 0, 1, 2. Let's try volume index 3, volume index 1. Volume index 0. Okay, so volume max 2 should be giving us the maximum value of the volume. What is that? I times this value by 255. That'll tell us what the index is. 2. And that makes sense because it's actually the first ID there that's been populated. So as I go down, we should see that as more layers get added, and as this max ID increases, we get each of those represented. Okay, so that's working, but of course it relies on the index of the volume remaining consistent. So what is the index? Well, it's just the order in which we see these different primitives, height, mask, and ID map. So in order to ensure that we always know the index of the ID map, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to do a little separate stream off to the side here, and we're going to delete all but the ID map, like so. And then the height field visualizer is going to have a spare input, and we're going to set the index to -1 there. That ensures. Ooh, okay, that didn't work. So what did I break? Ah, yes. And then that ensures that the, I need to set this back to 0, because now there's only one index on this. If we have a quick check, we'll see there's only one primitive of index 0. So that ensures, if we do this here, that it's always going to find the correct value. And there we have our basic setup. Which allows us to very easily sort of reorder these different operations and have a nice visualization of what's going on. And I suppose the very last step, you could leave this external like so, or if you like simplicity, gone, dive to the side, export. Embed the ability to export the ID map directly. On the node itself. Okay, so we took our sort of basic workflow that we created in the last session, where we were converting masks to ID maps, to a single ID map texture, sort of embedding lots of data into one ID map texture. And we've taken that principle and we've now sort of reformatted it in a more modular and reusable way, which supports kind of developing that process modularly and keeping your node graph quite a bit more organized and cleaner. And this is more suitable for production and much closer to what we did on Project Pegasus. So in a future video, we're going to be looking at how we use this improved workflow to iterate on the masks or the ID map that we're creating, taking that into Unreal and expanding on the material there so that we can basically finish the material with sort of normals and maybe some other kinds of macro texture blending, sort of working towards a sort of finished result. And then also, if you're interested in slightly more technical subjects, we'll be looking at how do we augment this node with some Python to basically allow you to pick the color of each of those layers for the preview to help with the visualization. And finally, we'll be jumping back into Unreal again to cover some even more technical subjects like editor extensions and how do we support manual painting of the ID maps directly inside of Unreal. Okay, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one.